Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Rodrigo Duterte, Fire and Fury in the Philippines, by Jonathan Miller. Narrated by Shaun, Grindell. Foreword. Addicted to Killing. At about the time I was assigned as Asia Correspondent for Channel 4 News and arrived back in the region, a foul-mouthed maverick mayor from Mindanao, an island in the far south of the Philippines, announced that he was going to run for president. Rodrigo Duterte possessed street charisma and had engagingly bad manners. Filipinos called this gangster charm and swooned. When Duterte called Pope Francis a son of a whore and got away with it in a country almost as staunchly Catholic as the Vatican, I began to pay more serious attention. This Mayor Duterte seemed like he could get away with murder. He presented himself as a man of the people, an insurgent outsider with no time for the corrupt oligarchs and dynastic elites of what he disparaged as Imperial Manila. He loved guns and girls and motorbikes, and hated drugs and crime and protocol. The Philippines, a tropical archipelago of over 7,000 far-flung islands and 100 million people, a quarter of whom live in poverty, was on the lookout for a savior. The mayor's rough-edged appeal cut across both class and wealth divides. Duterte's brazen, cavalier style made Filipinos laugh and feel good about themselves. In his own words, he did not give a shit about what people thought, particularly when it came to human rights. After years of feckless liberal leadership and decades of deference to America, the former colonial ruler, here at last was a straight-talking politician with simple solutions to national problems. Duterte claimed to be a socialist, but didn't peddle ideology. He spoke the gutter language of the poor and was a shameless populist authoritarian at the vanguard of an emerging New World Order, way ahead of Donald J. Trump. Duterte promised that, as president, he would do just as he had done as mayor of Davao City, rid the place of bad guys, and do society a favor. He reveled in his nom de guerre, Duterte Harry, after Clint Eastwood's shoot-first-ask-questions-later vigilante cop, Dirty Harry Callahan. "I am your last card," he told an electorate in his thrall. "I promise you, I will get down and dirty just to get things done. All of you who are into drugs, you sons of bitches, I will really kill you. I have no patience. I have no middle ground. Either you kill me, or I will kill you idiots." Rodrigo Duterte cleaned up all right. He won by a landslide and immediately began to deliver on his promises. On day one, he launched a Latin America-style dirty war, and with it introduced the darkest of Latino shadows, the Death Squad. By the end of year one, he was presiding over the largest loss of civilian lives in Southeast Asia since Pol Pot took Cambodia back to year zero. 10,000 in just 12 months, most of them dirt poor. In Duterte's reign of terror, death squads roamed the slums, and within months of his coming to power, these vigilantes had killed three times as many Filipinos as died in nearly a decade of martial law under the disgraced dictator Ferdinand Marcos during the 1970s and 1980s. Duterte set about rehabilitating the reputation of Marcos and his clan. To many, this felt like a frontal assault on the collective memory of a still unresolved national trauma, but the president declared it was time to bury the past. He approved the reinterment of Marcos' body in the National Cemetery of Heroes, set about abolishing the agency still trying to recoup most of the $10 billion plundered by Marcos and his cronies, and supported an electoral challenge which could yet engineer the installation of Ferdinand Marcos Jr. as his vice president. Ferdinand Jr. and his sister, Aimee Marcos, governor of the family's home province of Ilocos Norte, began to accompany Duterte on foreign trips, most notably on a state visit to China in October 2016. A year later, a new 12-peso stamp was issued bearing the smiling face of the dead despot. Many Filipinos were aghast. A meme circulated on Facebook. New Marcos stamps won't stick. People are spitting on the wrong side. With the daily bloodbath splashed across the headlines, in February 2017, Duterte jailed Senator Lila de Lima, the former Justice Secretary and his leading critic. The charges against her were condemned as pure fiction and politically motivated by human rights groups, and had followed a vicious campaign of harassment. He aggressively attacked the Catholic Church, his chief justice, and world leaders who criticized his drugs war, including then-US President Barack Obama, who, like the Pope, was awarded the Order of Son of a Whore. Duterte turned his back on America, the Philippines' strongest ally, in favor of Beijing and Moscow. Across Asia, a region where cultural rules of behavioral etiquette are strictly observed, people were struck dumb by Duterte's recalcitrance and effrontery, and watched events unfold with an uncomprehending and embarrassed fascination. In May 2017, Duterte declared martial law in Mindanao and gave the army a free hand to wage wars against Islamists and communists. Dissenting voices were drowned out by the president's army of cyber trolls on Facebook, and by the end of his tumultuous first year in office, he was more popular than when he had been elected. Duterte basked in the sort of approval ratings usually associated with totalitarian regimes. Congress has since acquiesced in backing the extension of martial law in Mindanao until the end of 2018. Every fresh profanity directed at world leaders would prompt demands for more Duterte from my London newsroom. And although I would happily oblige, because he was indeed good fodder, friends and contacts in the Philippines saw in him a much more menacing figure than the entertaining cardboard cutout loudmouth he was initially portrayed as abroad. Among the Filipino conoscenti, aware of what had really happened when he was mayor of Davao City, the mood was dark. From the start, they had shuddered at the prospect of what he would do as president, like the frisson that rippled through liberal America when Trump announced his intention to run for office. But worse, much worse. The little already written about Duterte was buried in local Davao newspaper stories, leaked US diplomatic cables, and decade-old reports by a UN investigator and a human rights group. These painted him as a violent authoritarian, the godfather of the dreaded Davao Death Squad, a cocksure mayor sincere in his belief that he was right, for whom the end justified the means. I grew up in Southeast Asia, and first visited the Philippines a few months after Marcos declared martial law. I remember the edgy atmosphere, and listening in to urgent conversations between my school teacher parents and their Filipino and foreign colleagues in Manila and Baguio City, the summer capital of the Philippines, as they grappled with the anxieties and fears that come with living under military dictatorship. It was along the Marcos Highway, on the way up to Baguio, that a much-hated 100-foot-high concrete bust of the dictator was later built. The statue was bombed by communist rebels in 1989, the year Marcos died in exile. As a student, back in 1983, I had read with horror of the assassination of Benigno Ninoy Aquino, the most outspoken opponent of martial law, just after he had landed, after 3 years in exile, at the international airport in Manila, which now bears his name. In remarkable television footage from inside the aircraft, Aquino told reporters, "I cannot allow myself to be petrified by the fear of assassination and spend my life in a corner." Minutes later, he was shot dead as he was escorted from the plane. 3 decades on, I could not help but wonder whether Filipinos in Duterte's Philippines would still be as shocked as they were then by such a killing. I had begun to doubt they would be, until the murder in August 2017 of Kian Lloyd de los Santos, a 17-year-old boy whose blatant extrajudicial killing at the hands of plainclothes police nauseated Filipinos and began to galvanize opposition to the drugs war and to Duterte. It felt like a watershed moment. In one snapshot of national public opinion following Kian's killing, the president's net approval rating appeared to have slid to under 50% for the first time, prompting headlines suggesting his political honeymoon might be over. Although another opinion poll contradicted this, indicating that Duterte's approval and trust ratings remained at 80%, the dawning of Duterte's downfall might one day be traced back to the teenager's sordid back-alley execution, just as the fall of Marcos was triggered by the assassination of Aquino. The month after Kian's killing, the powerful Catholic Church found its voice, ordering that church bells be rung at 8 p.m. every evening across the archipelago for the next 40 days, in protest at the killings. At the end of January 2018, a Philippine court filed charges against three officers over the murder of Kian Lloyd de los Santos. By then, Duterte's war on drugs had been raging for more than 18 months. As this book goes to press, only a handful of homicide cases arising from the war on drugs have made it to the courts, and there has not been a single conviction. Because the judicial system had proved unable or unwilling to bring the killers to justice, the chief prosecutor of the International Criminal Court in The Hague announced in February 2018 that she would launch a preliminary examination of the killings linked to the war on drugs since Duterte became president. He responded by denying he had ever given an order to police to kill drug suspects, and his spokesman dismissed the move as a waste of the court's time and resources. As a journalist, I based myself for a decade in Southeast Asia, living between Malaysia, Singapore, Cambodia, and Thailand, and covering the region. In 2001, 3 months after 9/11, I was the reporter on a documentary for Channel 4 on the war against Abu Sayyaf and other Islamist insurgent groups in Mindanao. It was there I first began to understand the depth of the bitterness felt by Filipino Moro Muslims after centuries of oppression by Spanish, then American colonial invaders, land grabs by Catholic Filipino settlers, and decades of insurgency. It would be another 15 years before the Philippines elected Duterte as the country's first ever Mindanaoan president. He seemed to offer fresh hope, but only to begin with. I had the first of several personal encounters with Duterte in Davao City, 6 weeks into his presidency, when martial law in Mindanao was still months away. The numbers murdered in his war on drugs had yet to reach 2,000, but the killing spree already had the world's attention. At a midnight news conference attended by the traveling presidential press corps and local journalists in Davao, I asked him to respond to accusations that he had unleashed a national death squad. As the only foreign correspondent present, it was easier for me to ask such questions. He retorted angrily, boasting of how, when he'd been mayor, he had ordered his courageous police to shoot to kill. Thinking I was an American, he railed against US hypocrisy. Police over there, he said, were shooting black men. What's the difference? I pointed out that these killings weren't sanctioned by the president, but he ignored this. The news conference was broadcast live on several TV channels, and our exchange notched up 13 million views on YouTube. The verdict? Foreign reporter trounced. Like others with the impertinence to ask such stupid questions, I received threats from Duterte trolls on social media. A few weeks later, I returned to Duterte's lair in Davao. This time, the president was fresh off a plane from meeting his professed hero, Vladimir Putin, at a summit. It was November 2016, and his other hero, Marcos, had been furtively reburied with military honors in his absence. Duterte took a few moments to eulogize the late dictator, and then reverted to his favorite theme, his drugs war, issuing threats and justifying the killings, which by then were approaching 6,000. The Philippines, he declared, was a narco state, as if we are now a country in Latin America, and he warned those playing narco politics that they would be killed. Standing at the microphone, I pointed out that the Latin American narco states he mentioned were associated with death squads, and said that in his first 5 months in power, death squads in the Philippines had already killed far more people than even Marcos managed. This provoked another anti-American diatribe, covering the US invasions of Panama and Iraq, the killing of children, adults, even the dogs and the goats, and the hypocrisy of the United States in criticizing him about human rights. "You destroyed countries," he said. The official transcript of that news conference, released by Malacanang Palace, did not record his final comment to me, but it was this that made national newspaper and television headlines the following day. The president asked if I had any more questions. As his communications secretary, a former TV journalist, physically pulled me away from the microphone by my shirt tails, Duterte said, "You cannot think of a question?" He muttered something about hypocrisy, and then, under his breath, he added, "Putangi namo, you son of a whore," but the microphones all caught it. The "mo" tagged on at the end made this particularly personal, I learned, one up on Pope Francis and Obama. As I returned to my seat in the room full of journalists, he said, in the Tagalog language, "Look at him, running off like a coward." Back in Manila, the following night, I joined a freelance Filipino photographer, Luis Liwanag, on what was known as the night shift, on the front line of Duterte's drugs war. This was the second time I had been out with the night crawlers, but by now the national kill rate stood at more than 20 a day. Not long after 10 p.m, we arrived at the scene of a death squad killing, within minutes of the shooting. Two masked men on a motorbike, we were told. A gaggle of teenagers had gathered outside a Dunkin' Donuts. They were staring sullenly at the body of a man sprawled on his back in the gutter right in front of them. A crimson rivulet of blood, oozing from the exit wound on the back of his head, was starting to mingle with rainwater in a curbside puddle. Police arrived and tied some yellow tape to nearby railings. They were practiced and unhurried in their routine. Traffic continued to move up and down the street, and all seemed normal, apart from the dead man in the gutter. A young woman in a passing jeepney taxi leant out and took a snapshot on her smartphone as a small crowd looked on. No one, it seemed, particularly shocked, just mawkishly transfixed. Luis had cut his teeth as a photojournalist during the final years of Marcos, and his dramatic pictures of the protests that led to the dictator's overthrow were emblematic of an era. A Leica camera was tattooed on his forearm, two Canon SLRs slung around his neck. Now in his 50s, and respectfully referred to as Sir Luis by fellow snappers, he was back, documenting the rise of a new authoritarian, and trying, he told me, to humanize the horror. "They're getting bolder. It used to be just in dark alleys. Now it's right in the center of a busy street," he said, breaking briefly to snatch a few more frames. "People are getting used to it. They are becoming desensitized. It's like a regular event now. A rampage of nightly killings. It's really horrible the way people are being killed like insects. Like insects." In the months that followed, these two words kept coming back at me as I delved ever deeper into Duterte's past and the systematic extermination program he had launched. He was, it seemed, addicted to killing. He might not have called drug addicts cockroaches, but he had questioned whether they were human and said he would be happy to slaughter them. If Germany had Hitler, the Philippines would have, he said, pointing to himself. It seemed to me that the Philippines had a much larger problem than drugs. It had a new dictator in the making. Months later, I spent an hour in conversation with Miguel Sohuko, the award-winning Filipino novelist who shared my obsession with the Philippines' new strongman. Sohuko was working on another novel and had recently been out on the night shift in Manila too. After writing several op-eds for the New York Times, he had received threats of violence and been subjected to character assassinations. When we spoke, events had been unfolding fast, and the drugs war's body count inexorably rising. Duterte had declared partial martial in the south and had mused in public about extending military rule across the Philippines. "History is repeating itself," Sohuko said, "even the names of the past are back. It's dangerous, not just because it's happening, but because we are letting it happen. Duterte represents what results when you allow democracy to be perverted, when the people consider it acceptable to have as ruler someone who is willing to discard the democratic checks and balances and any laws he feels inconvenienced by. What scares me most," he said, "is what our democratic institutions will look like at the end of this. The legislature, courts, media, the church, the opposition. He has gone after anyone who has stood up to him, and he has, very effectively, used his mob of trolls and propagandists. Democracy isn't just the majority voting in whoever we want," he said. "Democracy is ensuring that even the minority is represented and granted equal rights. 30 years is an entire generation, over which the people of the Philippines have forgotten the lessons of dictatorship." Within a few weeks of our speaking, Duterte's allies in Congress moved to impeach the chairman of the Election Commission, the Chief Justice, and the Independent Government Ombudsman. Under the pretext of his war on drugs, Duterte had declared war on the rule of law, replacing it with justice from the barrel of a gun. When I sought answers from the presidential palace about exactly what was happening, my questions were dismissed as malicious. The president was decisive, I was told. He does not pander to Western liberal perspectives. I have an aversion to Western foreign correspondents parachuting into countries and pontificating sagely about what they think is going on. That is why this book is drawn almost entirely from what Filipinos have told me about what they think is happening to their country. I have listened to Duterte's critics and to members of his family, to ministers of his cabinet, and to other loyal supporters, including priests, civil servants, newspaper editors, and close associates. And of course, I have listened to Duterte for hours and hours and hours. I brought this on my own head, having taken on this book. Putangina. It has been a form of self-inflicted, slow and painful torture. My observation is that, while Filipino journalists continue to document the killings and the president's pursuit of ever greater powers, the noose will tighten on Asia's oldest democracy. An atmosphere of intimidation has enveloped the Philippines under Duterte's increasingly authoritarian regime, and his heavy-handed style of governance has been enthusiastically endorsed by Donald J. Trump. I personally know journalists, human rights defenders, lawyers, opposition activists, and politicians who have been threatened, some with death. Many I spoke to requested anonymity because they were so fearful of the repercussions. For Filipinos who keep their heads below the parapet, life just goes on. They're aware, of course, of the killings, and still intrigued by the antics of Duterte Harry and his iconoclastic outbursts. But if you are middle class and educated, the closest you're likely to come to Duterte's death squads is when you chance across a paragraph in a paper reporting some slaying in a slum you've never been to, or your eye is drawn to the photograph of a 5-year-old who's been shot and whose killer will never be caught. The writer, Margaret Atwood, captured well such collective insouciance in her 1985 book, The Handmaid's Tale. We lived, as usual, by ignoring. Ignoring isn't the same as ignorance. You have to work at it. Nothing changes instantaneously. In a gradual, heating bathtub, you'd be boiled to death before you knew it. There were stories in the newspapers, of course. Corpses in ditches. Over the months, I spent researching and writing this book. That's how it felt in Duterte's Republic of Fear. But as the temperature rose, a growing number of ordinary Filipinos began to show signs of discomfort, distress. It just became harder and harder to ignore what was happening. Jonathan Miller, Bangkok, March 2018. 1. Cardboard cutout. In a disappointed country, where the promise of a half-forgotten people's revolution had been squandered, and memories of dictatorship and Imelda's shoes had faded, they were finally ready for another strongman. The age of anger was dawning in the Philippines. The fuse was lit. And, as the presidential election of May 2016 approached, Duterte Harry swaggered into the political arena, threatening to blow punks' heads clean off. "Kill them," he'd say. "Make my day." Rodrigo Duterte reassured his audience that killing criminals was nothing new to him. "If I have to kill you, I will kill you personally," he said. This became his rhetorical refrain, which he delivered in such an informal, understated, poker-faced way that no one could be sure if he was joking. It turned out that he wasn't. The core election pledge of the Law and Order candidate for 16th President of the Philippine Republic was mass murder, pure and simple. The shameless comparisons to Idi Amin and Hitler would come later. He had never killed an innocent human being, Duterte said, as he vowed to exterminate a species of subhumans, the sniff dogs and dealers at the heart of what he claimed was a national methamphetamine pandemic. This had been allowed to fester for far too long, he declared, to the point that it posed an existential threat. Filipinos had long known that their country had a drug addiction problem. Until now, though, they hadn't realized that it threatened national security. But when Duterte assured them that it did, they believed him. The broken justice system could not fix things, he told the people. And in that, he was not wrong. But he had a final solution of his own. "There will be blood," he said, and promised carnage. "God will weep if I become president." Bombast and bravado dominated his obscenity-laced campaign speeches, in which Duterte raged and swore to kill the vermin of the drugs trade. "These sons of whores are destroying our children," he said repeatedly. He promised to dump so many bodies in Manila Bay that the fish would grow fat feeding on them. Every speech contained murderous threats, and later, often included incitements for ordinary citizens to take up arms themselves, as vigilante killers. The funeral parlors would be packed, he predicted, accurately. Duterte's filthy mouth made him headline news. The more he cursed, the more media attention he won, and the more his growing army of supporters laughed and loved him. To lighten up his menacing invective, he boasted of his philandering and cracked jokes about rape. There were, of course, many Filipinos who balked at his boorishness, appalled by his unfiltered outbursts and vulgarity. He had the bearing and behavior of a gangster warlord, and sold himself as an outsider from the far south, where, as a local mayor, he claimed he had sorted out a troubled city's woes. His master plan as president was simple: to nationalize the franchise he had founded. He said he had a winning formula. In crime-infested shanties across the archipelago, his take-no-prisoners style made him wildly popular. He was a tough guy hero who had cojones, or as they say in the Tagalog language, may bayag, he's got balls. He spoke the salty language of the poor, uncouth, unvarnished, like nothing they had ever heard before from someone with his sights set on Malacan Yang, the grand colonial-era presidential palace on the banks of Manila's Pasig River. But Duterte, a lawyer by profession, shrewdly played to the fears of richer Filipinos too, and their perception that violent criminality was rampant. For those who swore allegiance to him, and he inflamed fierce loyalty, Duterte Harry was a revenge fantasy come true. Nothing was sacred. In a devout Catholic country that idolized America, he called both the Pope and Obama putangina, and discovered that this did not dent his popularity at all. He warned the Roman Catholic Church, the Philippine national media, foreign governments, and anyone with temerity to suggest his methods were unsound, don't fuck with me. He is being used as a vehicle of the Holy Spirit, his elder sister Eleanor explained. The country is in such turmoil and is so dark, we have to cleanse it. You cannot see the light until you clear the path of darkness. If it is your destiny, it is your destiny. Long ago, she said to me as we climbed the creaking staircase of what she grandly called the ancestral home, to which the family had actually only moved when Rodrigo was a child, a clairvoyant told their mother that all that has now transpired had been written in the stars. One of your sons, she'd said, and Eleanor stressed that she obviously meant Rodrigo, will, by destiny, assume a very high position. What made him president? She asked me rhetorically. Destiny. The father's will. Lucifer will never win. In Eleanor's messianic vision, anyone who challenged her brother was an emissary of Satan. We reached the top of the paneled staircase, and there, from a gold and dark wood frame, a cocky-looking kid stared out from a fading sepia-tinged photograph, printed onto canvas. His right hand was resting on his hip, and with his left arm he made the pretense of leaning rakishly on a badly drawn, ornate column on the set. See that young boy with a cap on his head? That's Rodrigo. That's him, 5 years old. The recalcitrant glare of the young Rodrigo Duterte is a vaguely menacing look, which the Filipino people have all now come to know. His expression, though, is hard to read, then as now. Those who love him see it as defiance. To others, it is the sneer of cold command. His sister, 3 years his senior, sighed. Typical mama's boy. He gets away with murder. Eleanor always used the present tense, even when referring to events from long ago. Those who've tracked Duterte's long and blood-soaked journey from that ancestral home to the Malacan Yang Palace with ever-growing alarm would not argue with Eleanor's unwitting verdict. On election day, Duterte won 16.6 million votes, 6.6 million more than his closest rival, and more than any other president in Philippine history, bar the rigged re-election of Ferdinand Marcos in 1981. He built a government on the back of his anti-criminality campaign, and he launched his dirty war well before his inauguration. Within his first 6 months in office, more than 7,000 people had been gunned down, twice as many as were killed during the entire 9-year-long military dictatorship of Marcos. To give this a sense of comparative scale, this was double the number killed in Northern Ireland's troubles over a period of 30 years. After that, the numbers in the Philippines just kept on going up. Suspects whose names had appeared on watch lists were shot dead in supposed encounters with the police, or by death squads, armed men on motorbikes in ski masks, who roamed towns and cities across the country with a license from the president to kill. These vigilantes were widely suspected of being off-duty cops or hired hitmen, who took orders directly from the police. The killings were called deaths under investigation, but there was never a real investigation. And until the end of January 2018, when three police officers were charged with murdering the teenager Kian Lloyd de los Santos, not a single prosecution. Even while president-elect, Duterte placed bounties on the heads of suspected drug dealers and addicts, inciting a killing spree by offering cash rewards to ordinary citizens. He scoffed at threats by human rights lawyers to hold him to account for command responsibility in what they said could amount to crimes against humanity. He marshalled social media and mobilised an army of diehard acolytes and trolls, branded the Dutertards by those they attacked. They fervently supported his drive to cleanse the Philippines of what they derided as scum. Once president, Duterte said there would be a price to pay for safety, and that price, he said, was human rights. Human rights activists and lawyers were both classed as legitimate targets for assassination. In May 2017, he even threatened to behead human rights activists who criticized his drugs war. Duterte sought to burnish his personal credentials as someone who killed bad guys, although the lawyer in him liked to keep claims vague. 8 months before he declared his candidacy, he told the magazine Esquire Philippines that he had first killed when he was 17, maybe stabbing somebody to death in what he said was a drunken beach brawl. "I have never in my life killed an innocent person," he reassured them. He made the same claim in November 2017. While addressing expatriate Filipinos in Vietnam, although on that occasion he said he was 16. The Esquire article was accompanied by striking black and white photographic portraits of him, posing in a combat jacket, cradling a long-arm weapon with a telescopic sight. He wore an identical, ambiguous expression to the one in the childhood photograph, sniper's eye and the trademark defiant sneer. In the months following his election, Duterte made many other boasts about his willingness to pull a gun and fire at bad guys. He said he had shot a fellow student while at school, and shot dead three suspected criminals while mayor of a distant place called Davao City. He even claimed he'd hurled a rape and murder suspect from a helicopter, mid-flight, narco-style. He'd done it before, he said, and would have no qualms about doing it again. He won a standing ovation at a national business leaders forum in Manila after he told them how, as mayor, he'd patrolled his city at night on a Harley Davidson, looking for an encounter so I could kill. During his campaign, he referred to Davao City as his Exhibit A and said he staked his credibility on his record there as mayor. When he burst onto the scene, as if from nowhere, as a presidential candidate, few in the capital and across the biggest island of Luzon, on which Manila stands, knew much, if anything, about the foul-mouthed, iconoclastic firebrand from the south. He had lived, since childhood, on Mindanao, the southernmost large island in an archipelago of more than 7,000, most of which have yet to be named. To the northerners, Mindanao is a faraway place where wars happen, the Philippines' wild south for centuries, untamed, and now beset by bloodthirsty jihadists, separatist insurgencies, kidnap gangs, pirates in the Sulu Sea, and in the mountains, guerrillas of the Communist New People's Army, all of them either killing or making a killing, or both. Mindanao was, and still is, regarded as a cauldron of Islamist violence, where Luzon Catholics fear to tread, a land where gun law rules. Its de facto coastal capital is Davao City, once the murder capital of the Philippines. For 22 years, it was ruled by a gun-toting mayor who, it turned out, had repeatedly been investigated for his alleged links to a death squad. The mayor gloried in the nickname Duterte Harry, and he had another name, the Punisher. In Davao City, a Pyongyang-style personality cult today surrounds their mayor-president. In hotel lobbies, shops, restaurants, the airport, and in local businesses, the man they just call Rudy skulks in person sporting a slightly unsettling half-smile. The cardboard cutouts are life-sized, and although the president is small of stature, it can be alarming when you suddenly become aware of a figure lurking silently behind you, and when you spin around, it's him. Sometimes he's wearing a trademark red-checked lumberjack shirt, sometimes a black polo shirt, and always jeans. Making these Duterte icons has become an industry in Davao. The cardboard cutout Rudys are everywhere, and come with identical weighted frames to prevent the mayor from toppling over and falling on his face. The cities are clean and ordered, and it's said to be completely safe to wander around at night. There's a building boom. The local economy is thriving. Speed limits are rigorously enforced. Smokers are banished. And children aren't allowed out alone past curfew at 10 p.m., or their parents face fines. And, like everywhere else in the Philippines these days, the scum get shot. Although, actually, that's always happened here. Today, the city's 1.6 million residents are too timid to admit what they know to be the truth about Rodrigo Duterte's lengthy reign of terror, because for three decades, they blindly acquiesced and kept their heads down. Many, including the local press, are literally indebted to the former mayor, beneficiaries of his largesse. Davaoenos will tell you that they love him. Local surveys put Duterte's approval rating at 96%. Surprisingly, though, even some of his most fervent admirers don't deny there's a climate of fear. Yes, there is, one conceded privately, but it's fear with respect, fear with love. In Davao, we are very proud of him. Over many years, the people of Davao grew to understand that resistance was futile. Those who openly opposed Duterte's tactics did not fare well. For some, their life expectancy proved short. Those supporting him found life improved immeasurably because, if there was ever a problem, the mayor was sure to help. Stories abound of his personal generosity. Duterte always stood in mayoral elections as the law and order candidate. He promised zero tolerance on drugs and criminality. In City Hall, he kept a loaded gold-plated revolver on his desk. During the seven terms of Mayor Duterte, the bodies of hundreds of street kids and petty criminals, as well as addicts and dealers of crystal meth, or shabu as it is known in the Philippines, were found dumped in Davao's back streets. Often their corpses were discovered with their faces wrapped in masking tape. Their hands were tied, and handwritten signs were hung around their necks. Addict, pusher, thief. The people of Davao City came to realize that these murders would all remain unsolved. They had watched their mayor's Hugo Chavez-style Sunday morning TV talk show, From the Masses, For the Masses, where he would brandish watch lists containing hundreds of named suspects. They knew that having your name on that list was as good as having a target painted on your back. Davao City was Duterte's laboratory for killing. It was to become his template, a political model for his brand of governance, for replication on a national scale. Between 1998 and 2015, more than 1,400 Davaoenos were murdered, some by 45-caliber handguns, others just by butcher's knives. The perpetrators of these unsolved murders were euphemistically labelled unknown vigilante killers, but everybody knew this to be the handiwork of what was ubiquitously referred to as the Davao Death Squad. Filipino and foreign human rights investigators venturing to Davao in those days linked the extrajudicial killings to the heinous crimes division of the city police, and pointed the finger firmly at Mayor Duterte Harry. He talked openly of criminals being legitimate targets of assassination, but denied any criminal liability himself. Locally, it was, of course, an open secret that Duterte was the godfather of the Davao Death Squad. He usually denied that, too, although on occasion he would boast of personal complicity. Once, on From the Masses, he made an admission which took people by surprise. "They say I am the death squad." "True, that is true," he said. With President Duterte ensconced in Malacañang Palace, members of that death squad, one a retired senior police officer who claimed to have been the leader of that infamous Davao heinous crime division, broke cover to testify under oath in the Philippine Senate. All that had been alleged was true, they said. The Davao death squad really did exist, and they had been in it. The mayor, the now contrite former killer said, had personally carried out summary executions, ordered countless other murders, and paid for hits in cash. These claims were summarily rejected by Malacañang, and no effort was spared to discredit his accusers. One fled into exile, the other went on the run. As president, the mercurial Rodrigo Duterte has, at times, proved erratic. But almost everything about the style and direction of his governance has been uncannily predictable, if not quite written in the stars. His personality traits, his patterns of behaviour, observable since his teenage years, throughout a 25-year marriage, and through his 7 terms as mayor, presaged exactly how he would behave as president. Duterte's attitudes to drugs and criminality, his methods for dealing with his critics, his views on Catholicism and communism, his opinion of America, the chip on his shoulder over historical injustice in Mindanao. It was all foretold. There are no antecedents. Foreign governments, and at home his political opponents, need only examine this past to gain an insight into what Duterte is likely to do next. And if the doomsayers prove right, among them a former classmate who's tracked Duterte's record for more than 50 years, senior lawyers, journalists, activists, priests and politicians, the joining of the dots is a trail that leads to darkness. Within months of coming to power, Duterte controversially ordered the reburial of Ferdinand Marcos in the Cemetery of Heroes, a hero who had overseen the murder, imprisonment, and torture of thousands of Filipinos, and plundered $10 billion from Philippine national coffers. The president regularly threatened to do away with habeas corpus, which allows for arrest without warrant, and repeatedly floated the possibility of his being forced to declare martial law, before declaring it across Mindanao in May 2017, to contain a small jihadist insurrection in the city of Marawi. Having failed to do so, he used the supermajority he commands in Congress and the Senate to extend this to the end of 2017, as concern inevitably grew that he would soon extend it geographically as well. Then, in December 2017, martial law in Mindanao and the suspension of habeas corpus was again extended, this time until the end of 2018, with Congress voting 240-27 to approve Duterte's request. The president used his allies in both houses to push legislation reintroducing capital punishment. His Eye for an Eye bill stalled in the Senate, but he has continued to press Congress to pass the legislation, which, if it is approved, would make the Philippines the first and only country in the world to renege on the abolition of the death penalty, in violation of international law. Duterte announced that he wanted to put 5 or 6 prisoners to death every day for various heinous crimes, including drug offences. The new authoritarian political order he established placed both the Philippine National Police and communists in commanding roles. He launched a brutal Lock Her Up campaign against his leading critic, the former Justice Minister and human rights investigator, Senator Lila de Lima, who was then arrested and detained inside National Police headquarters. As the months went by, he launched further attacks and threats against the handful of remaining senators who dared to question, criticize, or condemn his ever more despotic governance. By October 2017, seemingly convinced of a plot to oust him, he warned he would declare what he called a revolutionary government and would arrest all his critics, amid growing concern that the Philippines were returning to dictatorship. The declaration of what's been dubbed RevGov would allow for extraordinary measures to cure a failed system. This would include the scrapping of the 1987 post-Marcos Constitution, the introduction of a tough new Internal Security Act, and the introduction of a federal system, something Duterte has long campaigned for. Critics claim it would be nationwide martial law in all but name. From day one of his presidency, fear and violence emerged as Duterte's favored tools for imposing order. Abroad, he quickly gained a toxic reputation as an authoritarian strongman. The violence he embraced to wage his war was condemned by many Western governments. But in Donald J. Trump, Duterte found a friend. Unlike his predecessor in the White House, Trump not only endorsed Duterte's drug war, but, to the reported consternation of the U.S. State Department, invited a leader the American press had long dubbed the Trump of Asia to the White House. A foreign correspondent friend, who spent years reporting out of Washington, D.C., observed, "Duterte behaves like Trump's inner demon." At the end of May 2017, a classified confidential document was leaked, or possibly hacked, from the Americas division of the Philippine Department of Foreign Affairs. It contained a verbatim transcript of a telephone conversation between Trump and Duterte. Its contents were confirmed as accurate by a senior official in the Trump administration. The US president's opening gambit went like this: "I just wanted to congratulate you because I am hearing of the unbelievable job on the drug problem. Many countries have the problem. We have a problem. But what a great job you are doing, and I just wanted to call and tell you that." Duterte thanked him, calling drugs the scourge of my nation. Trump told him he understood, adding that "we had a previous president who did not understand that." Having praised his war on drugs, Trump went on to consult Duterte about a paranoid, malignant narcissist who was causing him some trouble. He was referring to North Korea's rogue dictator, Kim Jong-un. "What's your opinion of him, Rodrigo?" Trump asked. "Are we dealing with someone who is stable or not stable?" "He is not stable, Mr. President, as he keeps on smiling when he explodes a rocket," opined Duterte. "Every generation has a madman," he said, and Trump agreed. "We can't let a madman with nuclear weapons on the loose like that." Then, Trump twice invited his Filipino friend to the Oval Office. "Anytime you want to come." Their alpha male bromance finally blossomed when Trump came to Manila for a summit in November 2017. In contrast to the animus Duterte directed at Obama, he serenaded Trump at a banquet with his favorite ballad. "You are the light in my world," he crooned. "You are the love I've been waiting for," before informing his audience that he had sung upon the orders of the Commander-in-Chief of the United States. The next day, prior to Trump's speech on regional security, the president told Duterte that his performance at the previous night's gala talent show had been fantastic. Duterte's spokesman later said that during their 40-minute one-to-one meeting, Trump made no mention of human rights, or what he called extra-legal killings, adding that the U.S. president had once again been appreciative of Duterte's efforts in his war on drugs. At home, Duterte and his supporters set about cultivating a contrived mythology of this iron-fisted mayor turned president, a fiction surrounding both the man and his achievements. It's a narrative mix of half-truths and untruths, corroborated by invented or exaggerated statistics and crowd-sourced surveys in which voters were members of his fanatical fan club. In mid-2017, an Oxford University study into social media manipulation by politicians in 28 countries analyzed Duterte's use of this cyber army to disseminate his alt facts and to round on his critics. It claimed his keyboard trolls were paid £150,000 during the course of the previous year to pump out his message. Duterte claimed he had only paid people to defend him on social media during his election campaign. But evidence, including personal experience, flies in the face of this. The president was dismissive of the study. Oxford University? That's a school for stupid people, he said. But the Duterte social media machine has proved devastatingly effective in a country which, according to a digital trend survey by Hootsuite and UK-based consultancy We Are Social Limited, now leads the world in terms of time spent on social media. Filipinos, it seems, are hooked, and on average spent 4 hours and 17 minutes each day on sites such as Facebook, Snapchat, and Twitter, more than half an hour longer than their nearest rivals, Brazilians. This might well be down in part to the hopelessly sluggish internet speeds in the Philippines, which ranks just above Afghanistan, according to the Akamai Technologies report in May 2017. For a while, mobile broadband speeds were among the fastest in Asia, though, and the number of social media users grew by a quarter during Duterte's election year alone. Malacanang judges its success by the number of followers, likes and shares scored by Duterte's most avid fans. But the troll farms are accused of employing fake accounts and algorithmic bots, automated response computer programs, to artificially inflate numbers and create the impression of a trend wave in public opinion. Pro-Duterte propaganda and fake news is nonetheless widely reported and apparently widely believed by clever people in the media and politics and the law, as well as by the millions of Filipinos who voted for Duterte, and doubtless millions more, now too scared to admit they didn't. One example of the government's use of fake news was a viral post by Duterte's campaign spokesman, Peter Tiu Lavinia, which defended the war on drugs. Lavinia cited a report about a 9-year-old girl who was raped and murdered. He lambasted human rightists, bishops and prostitutes for their failure to condemn what he called this brutal act. They, he said, were derailing the government's war against drugs and crime. In Trumpian style, he went on. Our righteous battles are fierce and relentless because we face the devil himself. We cannot be soft or let our guards down, lest we ourselves be devoured and be defeated. Below this, he posted a graphic and distressing photograph purporting to show the dead child and her weeping mother. As the online news website Rappler would later point out in a series of articles which showed how the government was weaponizing the internet, the photograph was taken in Brazil, not the Philippines. But few stopped to challenge the Duterte propaganda machine's assertions, or to dig into the president's record as Davao City mayor, or indeed question whether his policy of ultimate deterrence had actually worked. It hadn't. National crime statistics contradict Duterte's claims that the city is transformed and safe. They show, for example, that Davao City remains the murder capital of the Philippines today, first among 15 cities, with more than 1,000 recorded murders committed between 2010 and 2015. The murder rate there is roughly twice that of New York City, a metropolis 5 times the size. In the Philippines, Davao also ranked number 2 for rape. In the city's slums, methamphetamine addiction remains rife. 30 years after the former mayor set out to cleanse the place of shabu, it's there, like candy, a Davao resident who is an authority on this, but who requested anonymity told me. And if more evidence were needed that Duterte's neutralization policy had failed to end the drug addiction problem, there's the fact that in the course of just 10 days, the first 10 days of his presidency, 17,211 drug users surrendered to police in the Davao region, fearing they would be shot by roving national death squad hitmen. Former addicts I met in Davao reckoned there were at least as many more who had not surrendered. Meanwhile, the statistics cited by the president to justify his war on drugs proved dramatically inflated, and his claim that the Philippines was in the throes of a drugs pandemic was overstated. When Reuters news agency in Manila ran a report questioning the exaggerated, flawed, or non-existent numbers cited to justify Duterte's drugs campaign, Martin Undanar, the president's communications secretary, dismissed the story as malicious and referred Reuters to the Philippine National Police. The drugs war has always had more to do with Duterte's personal ambitions than it has to do with drugs. Dealers and addicts proved a popular and easy target. The self-confessed leader of the Davao Death Squad said that, among its members, the mayor had always been referred to by his codename, Superman. It fitted with Duterte's own projection of himself as a self-styled superhero, savior of Davao. Today, Duterte runs a national salvation project in which he has promised the restoration of national pride and deliverance from evil. An instant hagiography was published immediately after his election. DU-30, Duterte, man of faith and fate. DU-30, Duterte, was his campaign nickname. The clenched fist his motif. The book's cover depicts Rodrigo as a knight, clad in shining armor. His helmet is removed to reveal his downcast face, and from one of the knight's dark, soulful eyes, a solitary tear rolls down his cheek. Duterte's band of loyal supporters, who hail him as a messiah, choose to overlook the inconvenient evidence of the mounting national death toll as the result of internecine feuding between the murderous gangs and rival drug lords. One of these Duterte devotees is Leo Villarreal, a former local radio reporter who went on to work as Mayor Duterte's chief information officer at Davao City Hall for many years. We met at a downtown restaurant in a renovated Spanish colonial villa. He was just back from Manila and could not resist telling me his news as we sat down. Villarreal had just been appointed chief communications officer at a government ministry in the capital, and was already working out the logistics of moving his family up there from Davao. Duterte has always rewarded loyalty. Villarreal insisted that the crime rate in the city had come down. He cited a crowd-sourced global online survey that in 2015 had ranked Davao City as the 9th safest city in the world. "It's one of the safest. It compares with Singapore," he laughed. "It's one of the best. He made it like this." Davaoenos must have voted in droves in that online survey, but that's exactly the sort of thing Duterte's online army does. Now that the former mayor is president, Villarreal said, he will solve the law and order problem. In Davao, we have experienced that. True, many do not like his style, or his bad mouth, or the killings, but after 2 years, we understood. And now, after 2 years, Filipinos, too, will understand what is his direction. Like other disciples in Davao, who had long ago drunk the Duterte Kool-Aid, Villarreal spoke with genuine conviction of his love and loyalty. It was as though he had been completely brainwashed. He, Duterte, said, "If I become president, it really will be bloody. If you aren't ready for my leadership, do not elect me. I will kill all criminals and addicts. I will bring a war against drugs and against corrupt people. I will kill them." And the people chanted yes, he said. With a triumphal final flourish, the zealous civil servant added, "I will die for my leader. I will die for him." But not everyone in Davao shared such unflinching loyalty. Virgilio P. Ver Bermudez edits Tribune News, a small local newspaper and has reported on the mayor-turned-president for nearly 3 decades. I met him at an outdoor bar in central Davao City, set back off the road and attached to a small hotel owned by one of the president's ex-girlfriends. There was a life-size cardboard cutout of Duterte in reception to remind guests who was boss. Armed with ice-cold bottles of San Miguel Pale, Bermudez and I discussed the unsettling sense I had in Davao, which had the veneer of a normal, functioning, busy city. I was surrounded by friendly people who did all the things normal people do, except ask searching questions about Rodrigo Duterte. We talked of the pride which Davaoenos naturally felt now that their mayor was in Malacañang, and how they felt entitled to ringside seats, which had for decades, centuries even, been denied to the southerners from Mindanao. Bermudez was bold in his observations, but cautious too, and was quick to defend Duterte and members of his family from wilder allegations, which he had no evidence to support. He leant towards me, across the table. Those who are loyal to him are all his beneficiaries, and they are all afraid, he said. If you ask the child of a murderer whether they still hold their father in esteem, they will tell you that their father kills so that they can survive. All of us knows that if you pull a trigger, you can kill. But few of us have the stomach for this. He does. 2. Son of a governor. He's in trouble. Again. Sometimes when this happens, he goes on the run for 3 days, in the hope that by the time he gets home, it will have blown over. But he knows this time, it won't end well. He's brought dishonor to the family name, and he's going to be crucified. You can't fire a stone at a priest from your catapult as he's mowing the lawn at your school. Spray ink from a water pistol on the back of another priest's cassock. Then play truant for 2 months, and not bargain on suffering for your sins. He will have to face his beloved mother, the Punisher. She makes no secret of the fact that he is her favorite. Often he can sweet talk her. Not this time. His normally soft-spoken father is furious. It's he who lays down the law, but it's his mother who is the enforcer. He doesn't feel remorse for what he's done, but it hurts him that he's hurt her. And being stoic and honorable, he'll take the rap. Horsewhip or crucifixion. It's not his choice. He hates the crucifix, but his mother is pious and devout. And when it's felt he needs to really contemplate his transgressions, this is her way. In the name of the Father. Upstairs, in the spare room, in front of the altar, Jesus, the Son of God, in agony, hangs there from the cross, suffering for the sins of this teenaged priest tormentor. It's in his face. He is kneeling on moonbeams, scattered on the hard wooden floor of the guest bedroom. Christ. His mother has ordered him to kneel with his arms outstretched, mirroring Jesus. And that's pretty much exactly as he told it to his best friend, Jesus. Duterte's oldest friend, Jesus Jess Doreza, his mucker-in-chief at Holy Cross High School in Digo City, Davao. Jesus, the journalist turned lawyer, turned peace negotiator, turned cabinet minister in the Duterte government. Jesus was waxing lyrical to me in his ministerial chambers in Manila. I'll tell you another story, he chortled. He was in full flow, and his young communications secretary, Basha, was smirking as she recorded and noted the drift of conversation. We would stay in the dormitory of the Brothers of the Sacred Heart, so we had to pray. He would say the rosary. One time he said, "Oh, you're always praying, Jess." At that time, I was planning to become a brother too. Planning. He would playfully say, "You're always bonding with Jesus." He said, "I had my bonding with Jesus. It took a long time. When Mother punished me, I was able to bond with Jesus Christ. She was an amiable, sweet person, his mother, but very, very strict, his old friend said, and he was an enfant terrible. This particular form of bondage scarred Duterte for life. Now in his 70s, he still talks about it. If the mixed signals of this act of penitence were hard for the diminutive 14-year-old Duterte to comprehend, so too are those he sends today as president. In his head, Duterte has always been on the side of the angels. He has always placed himself at the heart of the salvation story he invented as the narrative for his life. As law student, state prosecutor, mayor, and now as president, he has raged against injustice and stood up to the bullies, on the side of the oppressed and the weak. But for all the noble convictions and the compassion those who love him say that he embodies, it is not what his victims, enemies, and detractors see. They see a cold-hearted tyrant, armed with an Uzi. In 2016, Duterte said he hadn't entirely abandoned his faith. A small wooden crucifix still hangs on the wall of the bedroom of the simple house he shares with honeylet Avancenia, chief among his mistresses, the first girlfriend in Davao. But he chose an audience of local industrialists to confide that he couldn't perform his duties and be a devout Catholic at the same time. Perhaps he detected a possible conflict of interest with the Duterte-Harry style of governance, having attended two Catholic high schools, been whipped by the deans of discipline, and lashed and crucified by his mother at home. Duterte today has little time for fornicating priests, hypocritical bishops, or the church in general, or, for that matter, the Pope. It was his old friend Jesus Doreza who was eventually dispatched to St. Peter's in Rome to make peace with the pontiff on behalf of the president in the wake of the Son of a Whoregate scandal. While seeking to explain that notorious papal slur, Duterte revealed that he had been fondled as a 14-year-old schoolboy during confession by a now long-dead American Jesuit priest, Father Mark Fulvey. When Fulvey returned to his native California in the late 1950s, he is alleged to have continued abusing children at a church on Sunset Boulevard, Hollywood, although he was never charged. In 1975, the year before Fulvey died, the Jesuit order reportedly shelled out $16 million US dollars to settle claims of abuse involving 9 American children over a 16-year period. It was probably the tip of the iceberg. Duterte later said that the abuse he allegedly suffered had, to a large extent, shaped his character, his politics, and his view of the world. That's how we lost our innocence, he said, adding that other former classmates at Ateneo de Davao High School had been molested by Fulvey too. Duterte said he hadn't reported being abused out of fear of what might happen. How could we complain, he said. We were scared. Other experiences in those critical teenage years would profoundly mold Duterte's character. Contrary to the mythology he has assiduously fostered as the people's president, a leader who understood the problems and spoke the language of the poor, Duterte was probably the most privileged teenager in Mindanao, a spoiled brat in many ways. For all his railing against those he branded the oligarchs of Luzon's political elite, he belonged to Mindanao's political aristocracy. The man who would become the world's most vulgar, foul-mouthed head of state was none other than the son of the governor of the vast province of Davao. Vicente Duterte, a lawyer and former city mayor from Cebu City in the Philippine Central Visayas region, moved to Davao City and was elected to the most prominent political position in Mindanao when his son Rodrigo was 14. Within 6 years, Vicente would ascend to an even higher calling, joining the cabinet of President Ferdinand Marcos himself. As the family of the governor of Davao, the Duterte offspring, there were four of them, had it pretty good, with a household full of staff, including a cook, a driver, and a boy.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.